Good afternoon. Nice to be standing here today here in Veghel. TEDx Veghel, a worldly initiative in a delightful Brabant village. A nice paradox. For me, it feels a bit like a home game today. I was born 10 kilometers away from here, but what is close to you also makes you the most vulnerable. After all, I'm just a simple guy from Lieshout, a small town. Let me ask you a question. What do you think? How many family businesses do we have in the Netherlands? How many? 275,000 companies. 275,000 family businesses we have in the Netherlands. And one third of them is in Brabant, in the province where we are now. 53% of our gross national product is coming from these 275,000 family businesses. About half of the employment in the Netherlands is coming from these companies. And if you know that only 30% survive the first generation changeover, and only 13% is surviving the second generation changeover, and just 3% makes it through the third generation. I am from the seventh generation of a real family business. But as I see it, it's not about family with the same surname as I have. Family is everybody who works with us. Here's the main issue. It's not about starting up a new business or a family business, but it's about making your business future-proof. If you look only at our sector, the brewery sector in the Netherlands, then 10 years ago, we had 12 breweries in our country. Nowadays, we have over 600, and most of them are small family craft breweries. The average lifespan of a company in the 1950s was 65 years. The average lifespan of a company nowadays is 15 years. And in the near future, it will go down to 5 years. 5 years. This is not only one generation. Something about myself. I grew up in a place nearby, together with my brother and sister and my parents, and I was playing with beer crates in the backyard of my parents' house. During all my school holidays, I was working in the brewery for vacation jobs. I started as a forklift driver when I was 12 years old. Then I went became an employee at the pasteurizing machine in the bottling plant. I was a driver for the Horeca transport. I worked in the administration till I was 18. When I was 14 years old, I already was traveling together with my father. We went to Italy, we went to Spain, to France, and was sitting next to him while he was negotiating with big retail clients in those countries. So I learned about beer and entrepreneurship at my mother's knee. For centuries, our brewery was just a sideline of a farming company. And back in those days, most breweries were starting in the same way. So from origin, we are a farming company. And it's still in our DNA. We are down-to-earth, a down-to-earth mentality, and we also have that farmer shrewdness. And we as a family always say we don't want to become the biggest, we don't want to become the strongest, but we want to become the smartest. We are David in Goliath world. And as a family, we can have a lot of courage to undertake a lot. Look at my great-grandfather and his three sons, Johannes Swinkels. In 1924, he built a totally new brewery. And actually, he closed down his other business. And this brewery was one of the first Pilsner beer breweries in the Netherlands. This was a complete innovation for the Dutch market at that time, 1924. Before the time, we were used to drink an ale type of beer, dark, without foam, without CO2. So he came with a new innovation to the market, Pilsner beer. And he got rid of all the other things he did. And he put all his money on the table to do this. He took a big risk. In this day and age, you cannot imagine the beer market anymore without Pilsner beer. And let me talk about the sixth generation. The generation my father, Peter Swinkels, together with his brother Fons, drove to Italy in the beginning of the 70s. And was armed with the latest football results and a tour guide. For 1 week, they were driving around in the country, and they sold, after 1 week, they sold one truckload of beer. Then they went to Nigeria, and they found out that people, because of religion, couldn't drink alcohol in Nigeria. So my father sold non-alcoholic beer before it was even made. So he called his cousin, Wim, and he asked to Wim, "Can you make an alcohol-free beer? Because I just sold alcohol-free beer." And Wim said, "Of course I can." And nowadays, alcohol-free beer is a big segment in the beer market and growing. Actually, we were the founders of alcohol-free beer. And now the seventh generation, my generation, we also have a good chunk of obstinacy. We did some risky takeovers. We invested in the non-alcoholic beer segment while this was while this nearly dried up. And we built up a new brewery in Ethiopia from zero. I hope that as we speak, we are writing history as well. Each generation has something to add to our business. Today, there are more than 200 family members involved in the business. But as I told you before, our family is much bigger than that. Our family consists of 1,800 employees. And together we are building on the family legacy. We are brewing and building together. So far the good news. But let me be honest. A family business can be a blessing, but sometimes it can be a curse as well. Because most family companies face a lot of challenges. How do you pass on a family business from generation to generation in a successful way? How can you assure that your children and grandchildren can all enjoy your legacy? How do you keep everyone involved, especially if you have more than 200 family members involved? How do you keep that gutsiness without tripping over each other? And what is it that makes a business, any business, future-proof, not only a family business? Even if the marketing mix is spot on, there are two things that could cause a family business to fail. The first one is taxability, and the other one is discord in the family. Don't worry, I'm not going to talk about taxes today, but I want to talk about discord. Discord in the family. This is the biggest bottleneck in any family business. So the family is the greatest strength, but also the greatest challenge of every family business. Just 6 months ago, I was appointed as CEO of our company. And before I was appointed, I took some time for myself to look back and to look around me. I was thinking about all those questions that I just asked. What makes a business successful and future-proof? And I found out that most companies that are very successful over time are very good in adapting to a new reality. They continuously adapt the business to a new reality. They are not doing on change only, they are in continuous transformation. They adapt to new technologies and deploy their finance strengths in a very smart way. Companies that dare to invest in innovation will often see a substantial part of that back in the business in three-year times. And this was also the way that I looked at our business. Look at, for example, my great-grandfather, Johannes. He became big because he had the nerve to do away all the old habits. He dared to take the risk and put all his money on the table. Yes, there was the family, but there was more the market, the objectives, the results, and the discipline. If you would ask people in my company, say something about Peer, then most people will say, he really can sink his teeth into getting the jobs done, especially when it's going to be difficult. And I did that based on the idea that the right focus within the business will ensure that you become a successful business on the long term. But today, I think differently. In the end, it's not about the specific business drive, not only about it. For successful businesses, the family is paramount. Maybe not so much in the literal sense of the word, but definitely in terms of a loyal, safe environment in which every employee can contribute something to your family and business. It's all about the family. And I mean family and employees. A strong family represents the strengths of any business and exceeds objectives, market conditions, and discipline. The art is not just to create a successful business model. It's about creating an environment in which people, your employees, can make a real contribution to it. It's all about empowerment in each and everybody of us. Because I believe that confidence in each individual can help us to build relationships. Making mistakes, of course, can be part of that. It's all about being honest and learning from your mistakes, but also to celebrate successes. And it can be also a challenge in our culture, the Dutch culture, in which criticism is seen as something, a kind of art. If I look back to my own career in the last 15 years, I've had moments in which I didn't feel the confidence. I was afraid about what other people would say. I was scared about reactions when I came up with some plan. And normally I came with plans that were a bit odd, a bit unusual. And I can tell you, it's not a nice feeling. Believe me, at those moments, I wasn't at my best. If you get confidence, and you're given confidence, people are becoming happy. And American research shows us that happy employees, happy people, are 43% more productive. And it's telling that only half of the Dutch population finds their work really worth it. Let me ask you a question. How many of you know somebody who's had a burnout? Raise your hands. Everybody. Nearly everybody knows somebody that has had a burnout. The number of burnouts doubled since 2012 in the Netherlands, according to the Dutch Statistical Agency. Together, we created a monster called the business world. Most companies are becoming KPI machines. It's not about the people anymore. It's only about the figures. And that is what really concerns me. I think that most CEOs should take the responsibility to do something about that. Nobody is unhappy from working hard in a company, but you will become unhappy if you're working in an unhealthy environment. And when I say unhealthy environment, I mean an environment in which you have gossip, a lot of workload, unrealistic goals, not being appreciated or recognized, politics, backstabbing, that environment. Together, we spend a lot of time at our work. And you don't want to worry the whole time about what your boss is thinking about you and how you have to manage all the conflicts and what your colleagues will say. It's a toxic waste of time. And you take that feeling home. And as a brewer, I say, it also ferments. Maybe you question yourself, what am I doing as CEO of our company to make the work environment better? I give you a small example. A few months ago, I started with a brew talk, the brew talk. It's a live stream. I do it on one location in the company, and it's all the people in the company, all employees, wherever they are in the world, can follow this. And then during this brew talk, I take people along to what is the result today, where are we going to head to as a company. But that's not the most important thing. The most important thing is I put employees in the limelight for a small or for a big accomplishment. Because I want people to be seen. Take Marion and Sandra. They work on the personnel planning department in one of our biggest breweries. In summer holidays, it's always a disaster to have a perfect operation because people are on holidays and we have temporary people taking over. If you have a perfect personnel planning, you run it smoothly. Last summer, it was fantastic because of Marianne and Sandra. Or take Peter and Willian. They were fighting for many years on a legal case because we had an infringement on our trademark in Albania. I want to make sure that everybody's contribution is seen. And the biggest thing you can reach if you talk about confidence is that people dare to make a choice in between their colleagues when they are talking to their colleagues and they know that their colleagues are thinking differently about an idea. This is very important because I don't believe in a compromise. A company cannot be successful if you build it on compromises. Because the biggest chance of a collision taking place is when you're in the middle of the road. In 1989, Berlin Wall fell. 1 million Russian soldiers had to go back home. They had no money and no work. And we saw it as an opportunity to sell beer and to recruit people. This was a big risk, because we didn't know if we would get our money back. And before we knew it, we had hundreds of containers with frozen beer in wintertime in front of the barrier of Russia, the border. It was a big problem. We cannot sell frozen beer, of course. Later on, we realized we could have made ice cream out of it. In spite of that, Russia is now one of our most important markets because we just took a chance. You cannot win if you don't dare to lose. I'm at the beginning of my journey, and I know that this journey will go with ups and downs. In a family business, it's everything but a short memory. It ensures a lot of common ground, but it also can mean that emotion can stick around. So the importance of a happy family is paramount for families, for family members, and for employees. And I believe that this will take our business further. My challenge will be to bring this company to the 8th generation. There's 120 family members you see here behind me. I hope and believe that they will baffle us, because they will give them the confidence and the understanding that they can take risks as well. And together, and with a big smile on their face. We have all the task to bring the smile, these smiles on faces of people, because it's all about people and their personal motives. Do you know what truly motivates your staff to go to work each day? Do you know what your employees would like to change most about the business? And do you know what really makes him or her happy? If you don't know, ask them. I want to be part of that 1% that takes the business to the 8th generation. Even I want to be part of that 0.5% that takes us to the 9th generation. I hope I will still be there when the 9th generation is leading the company. And probably at that time, I'm sitting at the sideline, knowing everything better, of course. I want to leave a happy family business for the next generation, for family and for employees. That is my mission and my contribution to history. It's not about building a family business. It's about building a business with a family, even in a family business. Thank you very much.